ourselves. So the way we did it was by explaining things in terms of a three-legged stool. We tried other metaphors and other similes, but this seemed to be the one that worked the best. So the first leg of the stool is the way we explain it to folks. So if you're trying to market the program, you might want to use this as well and benefit from our experience, was editorial, which is also known as proactive. This is how we describe ourselves to our audience on our traditional corporate channels. This is what people typically think of when they think of social media. The second leg is social customer response. So the former was what we have to say about ourselves. This is what people are saying to us when they're asking for assistance on our corporate Twitter and Facebook accounts when they're looking for some help. And the third is business intelligence. So the first is what we have to say about ourselves. The second is what people are saying to us. And the third is what people are saying about us on traditional and social media. One key way in which we differ from PR is that PR may look at what a journalist has to say about us. We'll look at what a journalist has to say about us, but then we'll also look at the reaction to what the journalist has to say about us. And we'll also, in addition to that, look at situations that sort of bubble up organically. So why are we here? For brand protection, to address IP issues, to address misinformation, to address misunderstanding. So a quick example is that we employ over 640,000 people. We're one of the largest employers in the US, and some people will falsely market themselves saying we have a special arrangement with USPS. If you want to apply for a job with us, just pay us $39 and you can take a test and we'll get you employed with USPS. Well, you never have to pay to apply for a job at USPS, but we have some customers who are being misled. And so we need to address that. So that's one example of IP that we'll use. And we'll use not only just legal, but we'll also use the inspection service. We work with a lot of different departments in order to address these issues. And it's not just brand protection. It's also looking at how people respond to our products and services. So last summer, we released these frozen treat stamps. They are scratch and sniff stamps. And people liked them so much that one person was actually inspired to do nail art in honor of these stamps. Not the typical application one would expect with stamps, but I did want to include this because the artist was actually, she's from Santa Monica, which is my hometown, and I want to give a shout out to my people. And then, as I mentioned before, we've got someone from HR who's embedded, who addresses a number of issues. About 80% of the traffic that she sees are actually from prospective employees, people who are looking for employment, they have questions about the application process, they may have been given incorrect information. We want to make sure the process is as smooth as possible for them. We also get questions from former employees who are looking to, they're engaging with us on their preferred platform of choice, which is social media. So if they may have questions about retirement, for example, we'll assist them there. We also have current employees who may be having concerns or difficulties and they're asking for assistance as well. And then another portion of our audience who reach out that our HR person assists with is people who have things to say about our employees, maybe positive things, like I just had a terrific experience, how can I reach out to this person? I'll get additional information, reach out to the local supervisor and say, hey, this person did a terrific job, it came to our attention, thank you so much, keep up the good work. And maybe someone who had a less than positive experience, and in terms of putting out fires, we want to give a very robust and very prompt response before they go to the media. And then we have folks who publicly identify as employees, but may not be representing the brand in the best light. So we're doing some brand protection there. We tend not to be punitive. We tend to be more educational in our approach, saying, hey, if you publicly identify as an employee and you say something that other people don't like, even if you have privacy settings, even if you communicate private mode, people can always send us a screenshot. So if you don't want us to know, you might want to take a different approach. So we address things very granularly in terms of individual needs, but we also look operationally. And a good example was, it was clear from the kind of influx that we were getting from folks that we needed to freshen up our social media policy for our employees and do some education around that. And it was also clear that we had this cadre, this band of brothers who bleed Postal blue, who love us, and they needed a little bit of coaching and some additional resources. So because of this program, we are now about to start an employee advocacy program in response to that identified need that we wouldn't have been aware of had we not had someone embedded in this program. So how do we use the data? So yes, I'm a data queen. So we use it to evaluate an approach and inform a response and modify operations. So I just gave you a real quick example in terms of HR. We were seeing how people were responding, what their questions were in terms of applying for a job. Were we communicating, addressing their needs accurately? Were people being misled? Do we need to get IP and legal involved, as well as the inspection service? And then in terms of modifying operations, yeah, we need to modify operations. We need to refresh and up our social media policy, and we actually need to start this employee advocacy program because we have this untapped resource that we need to provide some direction to. So, in terms of who we are and what we do, we basically have a couple of different tools, and our reports tend to be very long, and they're very long for a very intentional reason. One is that our audiences are very diverse. Some people want quantitative information, some people want qualitative information, some people just want the top notes and that's all they have time for. Other folks really want to get into the weeds. And because we have different people with different learning styles, we present it all. And we do it in a very standardized way. I sort of think of it as like a Chinese takeout menu. Different people are going to want different things, and they're going to go to the part of the menu that best speaks to their interests. So our two main products are our daily listening and insights report and our topical report. So our daily insights and listening report is an overview of traditional media, of social media, also any policy mentions or issues that are coming up, anything members of the industry have to say. As well as organizing news by postal area. The audience for this is very diverse, and it really informs operations in a number of ways. We have some people who are in communications at the ground level. It lets them know what's being said about them and their little social economic sphere and their little ecosystem. And it helps them prepare a response if someone should reach out to them. It also helps them develop their contact list next time they need to reach out to the press in their local area. It also helps staffing issues. So, for example, if a local post office is getting a lot of traction because they're doing a passport fair, it helps them to inform operations saying, hey, we got a lot of press coverage on this. Maybe we need to increase our staffing this Saturday. We also look at because people will find really good user-generated content that can be repurposed for a number of reasons, either for our editorial or internal publications, or just to reach out to someone and say, hey, you did a really good job, and we wanted to recognize that. The second deliverable that we have are topical reports, and they can be on a number of issues. It could be a video that's trending, it could be a particular product, it could be a particular service. And as I mentioned before, our daily insights report, our work is never done with this. We're constantly working on our sensitivity and specificity. And our demand for this product is pretty big. And the way we measure success is the number of people who keep asking to be put on the mailing list to receive this report. And so here's some examples. You can sort of see to the right, this is what it looks like for the traditional mentions that are arranged by postal service area, so people can just go in and see the information that they want. We also have some verbatims. On the previous slide, what you saw is Operation Santa. Let me go back. I'm going to give up on that. All right. Operation Santa. So how many of you have heard of Operation Santa? Oh, that's great. Okay. So winter season is sort of like our Super Bowl, and so we started this program in New York, and basically you can go in and send a package or a Christmas present to a needy child. We've since expanded that to 6 different cities, and because of our relationship with Puerto Rico, we've expanded that to Puerto Rico as well. That would be an example of something we would do a topical report on. We also have things like letters to Santa, where an adult can write a letter on behalf of Santa, send it to Anchorage, Alaska. It'll be postmarked North Pole, and the kid will receive it, and it'll have the response that you see below. All right, so topical reports. So you can see the topical reports, we use pretty sophisticated Boolean language to map out what's going on in a situation. When we do this, we're always asking 3 questions. Is it trending? Does it merit a response? And if so, what should the nature of the response be? And we do a pretty deep dive. We want to know where exactly the conversation is taking place, what the nature of the sentiment is. Is it good? Is it bad? Is it ugly? And we also want to know who is saying what. So if you see these blue circles, I know it can be hard to read. Those blue circles indicate level of influence of who's making those comments. So is it grassroots? Is it grass tops? All of these factors will inform the kind of response that we provide. And as I mentioned before, we get into verbatim. So this is a great example. So in the California wildfires, there were some folks who lived in particular areas that said, please continue to deliver mail to us. So they continued to deliver mail to us. And someone started to film it. And the actual video went viral. It went crazy. And because we had that information, we contacted local office and said, hey, there's this video that's going viral. It's really incredible footage. Wanted to let you know. Give you congratulations. You're doing a great job. But at the same time, because they were given a heads up when local media reached out to them and said, oh, yeah, this is why we're delivering this really desolate area, because our customers asked us to. And we know who the carrier is. Would you like to do an interview with them? And so because we were able to give them a heads up, they were able to actually make the most of that opportunity that was generated by an amazing filmmaker. And likewise, we'll look into other things. So for example, we did a partnership with Forever 21. You can see some of the responses. The mail clutch sold out like that. It's also evidently Pitbull approved. And as I mentioned before, we use this content for a number of different things. So we'll use it for user-generated content in our own editorial, or we'll use it for giving kudos, we'll use it for internal publications, and we'll also use it to validate some of our own responses. So for example, the one about Christmas, that was a verbatim I used when we did our postpartum review of how we did over the holiday season. I used this particular quote to explain what the overall sentiment was in terms of how people perceived our service. Another example would be looking at particular products. So when we released the John Lennon stamp, response was overwhelmingly positive. We also heard from someone we didn't expect to hear from, and this was international customers who wanted to buy our product. And they were really frustrated because they couldn't buy our product because we don't offer purchases on our website to folks from outside the US. We offer it to folks on eBay, but not our website. But if you go to our eBay site, it didn't have any John Lennon products. So what we were able to do is provide real-time feedback saying, hey, we need to get this product available on eBay right away. Otherwise, we're going to miss this opportunity. What was helpful was that we actually were able to demonstrate a learning curve. So when people heard it through the grapevine that there was a Marvin Gaye stamp, and yeah, I went there, we were actually more prepared. And so we had our stock available on eBay for our international buyers, and they were able to get the purchase that they wanted to. And by having that additional information, we were able to demonstrate our value. So Sunday priority delivery. Sunday priority delivery was something that was tested out in a select number of urban areas. We normally don't deliver on Sundays. We were going to deliver on Sundays. Let's give it a shot. Let's see what the feedback is. And we expected people to be surprised. We also expected security concerns, like, are these people really from USPS? Are they really delivering on a Sunday? And that's not actually what we saw. What we saw was overwhelmingly surprise and delight that people are getting their packages on a Sunday. That's great. But then right underneath that, so 38% surprise and delight, 28% then followed up with service concerns, which kind of makes sense if you think about it. If someone's delivering on a Sunday, they're not your typical employee, they're not the regular carrier, so they might make mistakes. Something could be predicted, but not something that we anticipated. But now that we know that, we can take action. We can inform operations, they can do a little bit more training or coaching or supervision for folks who work on Sunday. And for customer service, they can be more robust on a Monday to respond to those concerns. And informed delivery by USPS, has anyone heard of this? Oh my gosh, that warms my heart. Okay, so this is something that 15 million Americans have signed up for. It is a free service. You get a daily email that you can look at, and it will give a photograph saying this is what's coming into your mailbox soon. Now, what we anticipate is that people are going to really like the convenience of it, particularly those who tend to travel and want to know what's coming into their box. So that's what we anticipated, but what we actually saw was people who really were, frankly, mostly interested in the personal security aspects, not the convenience, but the personal security aspects, because they saw it as a way of protecting themselves against identity theft. Other people like other aspects, like I know when to go to my mailbox, which is kind of far away because I live in a rural area. Another person loved it because she was able to convince her family that she has psychic ability. But most people liked it because they felt it gave them protection against identity theft. We also saw some other things, too. One was that we had an untapped market that we hadn't anticipated. And these were folks who have post office boxes. They're like, wow, we would like to get the service, too. We also saw that it highlighted some deficits in our service. And we also saw that there was a misunderstanding in terms of the intent and the reality. So the wording is coming to your mailbox soon, and people interpreted that to mean coming to your mailbox today. So there's a miscommunication that needed to be clarified. We also saw that people are using it in ways that we didn't anticipate. So for example, some law students are using it to find out whether or not they got into law school. So like you get a big envelope, you got in. If you got a small envelope, you need to apply elsewhere. We also saw feedback from folks who were saying, well, why don't you use this informed delivery service to let us know if there's a service problem because of the weather? Well, that's something we hadn't thought of before, and that's something we're looking into implementing at this time. But again, feedback we never would have gotten were it not for this social business intelligence program. It's sort of, I think there's sort of sometimes a failure to recognize that what we do is almost a de facto focus group for free. So not everything requires a response. So there was so Market watched an article about us that was not flattering. And it criticized the fact that we were participating in an electronics conference called CES. And so this is how we differ from traditional PR and the traditional PR response. The traditional PR response would have jumped in and said, oh my gosh, there's a misunderstanding, you don't understand. They would have treated it like a teachable moment and come in, and it could have come across as a bit defensive, maybe condescending, and it could have backfired in terms of adding fuel to the fire. What we looked at were the responses, and responses were really overwhelming. There were hundreds of responses of people coming to our defense. It was very robust, very well-informed, and why would we jump in if these people are fighting our battle for us? Not only they fight their battle for us, but they're providing accurate information, and because it's coming from them and not from us, it was information from a more credible source. And I can't tell you the number of times that we've actually demonstrated our value because we would say, you know what, this issue is not trending, there's no need to respond at this time. Or this issue is trending, but you know what, people are fighting our fight for us, we can kick back and just monitor the situation. Hurricane Maria, okay. So, when Hurricane Maria affected Puerto Rico, we could get pretty granular. We could see from folks, people were asking, is my post office open? And we have a website that declares whether or not a post site is open. And I reach out to them, like, well, no, my post office is not listed. Well, I speak Spanish. I call down there. And we found out whether or not their post office is open or whether or not services were limited. And then I was able to do two things. I was able to get back to the customer immediately and give them an answer to their question. I was also able to go to my friend down the hall and say, hey, you know what? Your website's not up to date. This is what's going on with this particular location. So because of what we were able to do, we were able to offer real-time updates in terms of what was going on. In addition to the very granular level, we were also able to take a higher view. And the higher view, we were looking at what people were saying about us and about other folks in the industry. And folks wanted to send a lot of things very quickly, very affordably, and very securely. So this spoke to our competitive advantage, which is priority mail. If it fits, it ships. So we started promoting that particular service. And then we heard concerns about theft. And when we took a deeper dive, what we found out wasn't so much theft, but that packages were opening in transit, and people were trying to pack them back as best as they could, but you know they may not be able to pack everything in, or you might find an item that came from another package in your package. So that led to another educational outreach, which is, you know what, if it fits, it ships, but please don't overpack it, and please use plenty of tape. It also led to the development of Spanish language educational materials, which we didn't have before, and there wasn't a perceived need before we started doing this work. And what was the result? A lot of love, frankly. People who work in the post office, we're from the community, we live in the community, we know the community, so we'll check in on people if someone's not doing well. And so we started getting emails from folks saying, USPS, thank you so much, you saved my mother's life. Because of you, she has her medication. Emergency services hasn't even been to our house yet. And then Reuters also did some acknowledgement as well. But this is something that we see every day. We actually have a Heroes Corner within our own internal publications. Like every single day, there's a carrier who found someone who had fallen and they needed medical assistance, or a toddler who was unescorted, or my favorite story, there's a house on fire, the carrier ran in, saved the customer, ran it again, grabbed the dog, saved the dog's life. The dog's name was Hot Dog. He was a Dodge Hound. I know. So there's tons of great stories that we need to get out there. And then in terms of informing editorial and recognizing patterns, so we touch people's lives every day. And a lot of people rely on us as a lifeline. If you're a small business, you rely on us as a socioeconomic lifeline. If you're a person who gets their medications through their mail, we're a literal lifeline. And so when there's a natural disaster, there's a certain set of questions that we always receive from our customers. One is, are you open? The other is concern for the well-being of the employees. Please don't make them go out in this weather. The other is, if you're closed, when are you going to open again? Followed by, hey, I've been personally affected, how do I hold my mail, or how do I redirect my mail? And then the final one is, well, an employee of yours was affected, can we help them? And so one of the things we started doing once we recognized these patterns is we started anticipating customer concerns with our editorial. In all other aspects of social media response, the numbers are going up exponentially. But once we started doing these sort of anticipatory editorials, our questions that we received from customers regarding, are you open? How do I change my mail? How do I put mail on hold? Those numbers actually went down significantly. They're like a fraction of what they were before we started doing this. And again, it's about identifying misunderstandings. So for example, a lot of folks don't realize that even though we deliver 47% of the world's mail, we don't operate outside the US, and that can lead to some confusion and some frustration. And so we've actually developed some editorial content to address that misunderstanding for a better customer experience. Then there's building community. So this is Finn. Finn loves sharks. You can tell. He was also delighted that we had shark stamps. So Finn also has a congenital heart defect. And because of that, he gets a lot of mail, so much so that he has his own post office box within his local post office. So everyone in the post office knows him. It's, again, part of one large family, one large community. When the shark stamps came out, they came to my attention. I was like, wow, you know, can I share Finn's story? They said, sure. Shared it internally, shared it with an external audience. When we released our shark stamps, I did my best to get him some shark-related swag. And then a year later, he's had surgery, he's doing really well, and again, he thinks of the post office as family. You can see he's dressed as the elf from the Elf on the Shelf, and he's handing out chocolates to say thank you for the local postal employees. And again, this is material that we purpose in a lot of ways. Firstly, just to say thank you to the local post office for doing such a fantastic job. Also, user-generated content for our own editorial, as well as internal communications with our own people, saying, hey, this is why we do this. This is why we are postal proud. And then for Puerto Rico, because we love Puerto Rico, we actually had our first day of issue ceremony for our love stamp in San Juan to demonstrate our love. And then this last story, this speaks to concern that our customers have for our employees. So a customer reached out to us saying, this is one of our carriers. We absolutely adore her. She lost her house. We have a GoFundMe page. Can you please help her? She's got a lot going on. She actually burnt her, not only did she lose her home, she actually burnt her hands severely, putting out the flames on her adult child, who has a number of health care concerns himself. And not only that, but the very next day, she actually officiated my wedding. Here's a photo of my wedding. You can see her officiating with these bandaged hands. Can you help me out? So we can't fund a GoFundMe, but we do have something called PERF, which is a Postal Employees Relief Fund. So I'm like, okay, we can't do that, but I can connect them with this other program. Let me get your information. And we were able to connect our HR person with our local postmaster to get this person some assistance. Because when we talk about products and we talk about services, it's really about people, and it's really about those products and services and their ability to bring people together and create that community. Okay. So selecting a software program. So as people get to know us, they come up with similar questions. When we had to move on to a different software program, we auditioned about half a dozen different companies. And what we found is that they all started to sound very similar. And it was very difficult to tease them out to figure out which one was the best fit for us. And so when we were talking to folks, the menu of services they offer sounded very similar. And when we'd ask them to do a sample report, they would say, well, you know what, we can do this, but the program's not fully set up, your billing's pretty nuanced, this is just a taste of what you could ultimately hope to see. And so that was kind of challenging because we actually had to consciously uncouple from our previous software provider because they weren't quite as robust as we would have liked. And we wanted to make sure that we were getting what we were hoping for. So how did we address it? Something really simple. We took a Sally Ride hashtag, we gave everyone the same function so that way you don't have to worry about the nuances of a Boolean, and we gave them a specific time frame, and we gave it to every single software company. So that way we could do an apples to apples approach to see who really is that robust on Facebook, who really can pull up that information on Instagram. And this assisted us greatly in making sure we were getting the right fit for us. Our hashtags, you know, did they start on Twitter? Yeah, but they're on other platforms too. And again, our intention wasn't an immaculate conception. Our intention was to be able to do an apples to apples comparison. All right. So to bundle or not to bundle, I understand for some folks, they don't have the luxury of making that choice. We are fortunate in that our budget allows us the luxury to make that choice. Because for us, having a suite of tools that best meets our needs is the more effective decision than having something that causes a lot of heartache and frustration and is ultimately inefficient. One of the things that we've noticed in the industry is that people understand the trend to want to bundle, and they try to be all things to all people, and they'll try to retrofit some of their software, basically putting a square peg into a round hole. So when we were auditioning companies, we went to visit them, and they were like, this is what we have for social customer response. And it was clearly a marketing software that they were trying to repackage for social customer response. And they said, well, if you see this customer, okay, they have these demographics, you can put them in this queue. If you see this customer, they have these interests, you can put them in this queue. From a customer service perspective, for me, knowing what their personal interests are doesn't help me. That's helpful in terms of marketing. It doesn't help me actually address their concern. So I'm sort of wondering like how knowing someone's favorite ice cream is going to help me find their package. And my colleague raised his hand and said, so how many clicks before I actually get to respond to a customer? And the response was, we have this great marketing software. It's like, okay, but how many clicks before I get to respond to the customer? And the response was, this is a terrific publication tool. So finally, we just said, listen, we deal with very high volume. It would be very helpful for us to see this in action with one of your larger clients. So no problem, no problem. Six meetings later, we finally got to meet with our largest client. And what we found was some big differences in terms of needs, in terms of responses. What they were doing in volume in a quarter is what we do in a week and a half. Similar size team. And because it's a different kind of company, not nearly as diverse issues, and also their associates were not empowered to take personal information. Well, our associates are empowered to take personal information. In fact, they'll handle the issue from cradle to grave. However long it takes to resolve the issue, if it's 2 minutes, if it's 2 hours, if it's 2 days, if it's 2 weeks, it's rarely 2 weeks, but just being hyperbolic, however long it takes, we'll handle the issue. So higher volume, more complex, more diverse, and not meet our needs. And having that information really helped to inform our decision. All right. So they say an expert is someone who's made every possible mistake in a given field. So we've developed some expertise, and we would like to save you some of our pain. So one of the things that when we've talked to people when they're looking at software is not just what do you like it, but what is it exactly that you do like? Because what might be a deal breaker for you may be a non-essential for me. Also, for me, it's less helpful to talk to lots of different people than to talk to one person who's used different types of software. So they can do like a real apples to oranges comparison. So there's theory and there's practice, and I'd rather talk to someone who's actually experienced both so they can give a more realistic assertion of a description of what's going on. The other thing that I pay attention to is where that person is located, because software is only half the equation. We had one person that we absolutely loved. We're based in Washington, D.C. She transferred to San Francisco, and we got a new social customer response or customer success manager, and it was a completely different person. It was a completely different experience. And if we had just started with that one person, we probably would not have stayed with that company. But because we started with this original person, we had a positive experience. We knew that wasn't the culture of the company. We were able to go to the company and say, hey, this isn't working out. We need to get someone new. But I've always held on to that experience. So when someone tells me they're having a great customer experience or a not so great customer experience, I want to find out what time zone they're in. Because chances are we're probably going to get the same customer success manager if we decide to use their software too. And then software, as I said before, is only half the equation. In my office, they love The Bachelor. I have not succumbed. The only other holdout, he like emails his little sister and she writes up summaries so he can participate in the conversation. But in terms of like my dream date, is someone who's willing to grow with me. So if they're willing to put in the time to put in a really good product, not only are they making themselves better for us, they're also making themselves better for the next customer. So if they're willing to work with us and take our list of 1,000 contacts and set up real-time alerts, so if any time any one of these folks say something about us on Facebook or Twitter, we get a real-time alert about it, that's fantastic. And that's actually something they can use with their other clients. Likewise, if they can develop a heat map using zip code, not geolocation, because we know that works maybe 30% of the time, but actually the holy grail of zip codes, and map it out by topics and concerns, that's someone with whom I can grow old with. That's someone I want to stay with. At the very least, what I'm looking for is someone who will be honest with me, and so who will say, you know what, that's not possible, here's why. Or that is possible, but you know what, it's not part of our research agenda right now, So I don't see that coming down in the pike anytime soon. Or someone will say, yeah, that's totally possible. Here's the timeline. Here's how we can make it work. And then they actually listen to the timeline. What I don't want to see is someone who doesn't speak to my needs or address my actual concerns. So for example, we report to the executive leadership our sentiment conversion rate. If it breaks down twice in a six-month period and it takes 3 weeks to fix it, that's very concerning to me. And if I bring that concern, I want a robust response, not a response where I have to follow up with you to make sure there's progress being made, but where you follow up with me to see the progress is being made. What I don't want is distraction or diversion, saying, oh, I'm sorry you're having that difficulty, but we have this new service that's coming down the pike. It's great there's a service coming down the pike, but that's not meeting my emotional need. Or, yeah, because you call it emotional need. And so just because we're polite doesn't mean we don't recognize distraction or diversion when we hear it. It can be very frustrating from the customer side. You say, I'm having a problem with my front door, and you're saying to me, hey, how about I build you a patio? And you're like, but I have a problem with my front door. You're like, hey, how about a pool? Okay, but I'm having a problem with my front door. Hey, how about a two-story garage? What's my problem? My problem is the front door. Sort of like saying to someone, hey, my house is on fire and you're offering to sell me flood insurance. That's not meeting my needs. So, fit for purpose. So part of it is, you know, I understand that the more services you're able to offer, the more marketable you are. But one of the concerns is that if I'm having difficulty with the current menu of services, how enthusiastic am I going to be with anything coming down the pike? Or as one of my colleagues said, so what they're offering is more stuff that may or may not work, yay. And then for me as a manager, that just means like more support orders that I have to babysit. So for me, I'd rather have something that's really steady that works all the time than a bunch of features that may or may not work consistently. In terms of fit for purpose, I talked a little bit about retrofitting. Some of the things are clearly designed for the ease of the software designer and not for ease of use of the actual user. So for example, reader fatigue is not something that all software companies take into consideration. They will say, okay, so on this screen, we have all the metrics for Twitter. And on this screen, we have all the metrics for Facebook. And on this screen, we have all the metrics for Instagram. And from a programming perspective, that makes sense because that's really easy. But from a read perspective, is my audience going to read seven different sets of metrics? No, they're not. And if they don't read it, they don't use it. And if they're not going to use it, then why am I here? So these are a couple of examples of metrics that I like. These are one and done, all the different platforms mapped out of time. You can see which platforms are trending, which ones are not. You can see, again, that nice handy-dandy all-in-one where it maps it out by platform, level of influence, and sentiment. And then what I like about the sentiment bar, it actually gives you the qualifier. So if, I don't know if you can tell them really small gray words. It says, out of this many sampled, this many had sentiment attached. I like that it actually has that qualifier attached. What we'll see sometimes with exports, because things aren't always export ready, is they'll either truncate the export or they won't provide all the information, such as the number of people for whom we actually have that gender or age-related data or engagement data. And then when we bring that up to the software designer, the response is, oh, well, you can click through. Or, oh, well, you can hover over that. Well, I can't export that. And if I'm sending this to a very larger number of people, they're not going to click through. They don't have the time to hover over it. And you can't hover over a PDF. So what is really the essence of the user's function? For whom are we actually serving? Ah. So that's my nephew. So in terms of our success, how do we measure success? One is for the demand for our services and also the range of topics that we're asked to investigate. So for example, in the past 6 months, we've done 172 reports on 82 different topics. And I think the fact that people ask for our work and use it consistently and report on it, and in fact that it informs operations, is a justification for why this is a program that should continue. And that's sort of the shtick we give to our ELT, and they seem to like it. Any questions or comments? Yes.
Did you mention what software that was? So what you ended up choosing in the bundle, or, I'm sorry.
Did you mention what, great job.
Thank you.
Did you mention what software that was, what vendor you went with for that last?
We use different vendors for different things. Right. So for the visuals that you just saw, those were Digimind. Okay. We use Lithium, now Kronos, for social customer response. We also use MailChimp. We use Google Alerts. We use a lot of different things. Again, so the key phrase is that we use a suite of tools.
Very good. Thank you.
Sure.
And Can I add on and then I'll stop?
Please.
I loved when you showed the real comments, because we use it too. We have listening, we're using different vendors. And what I struggle with sometimes is, you know, there's one or two comments and maybe we're not using the right vendor, but to see the volume of that same type. Like mm-hmm. you had that Sunday delivery and you broke it down by project. Yeah. Did that come out of the software or did you have your people kind of mining it a bit more?
Great question. So this is labor intensive. There's no. So how did we come up with those particular categories? It was our folks going through the verbatim saying, this is the these are the patterns that we're identifying and let's go ahead and try to quantify them as well. Real people never, the software will never replace real people because real people need to be able to exercise that judgment and nuance and discernment and decision making. Some people rely on word clouds, but word clouds would never have given us that level of insight. Any other questions, comments? In the back.
Thank you for a great presentation. Your daily insights report,
yeah,
is that done via Digimind or which vendor does that?
So it is a combination.
Okay.
So
that's a combination also?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a combination. And so like, so part of it is, I think if you want to meet with the Digimind folks, they're right here. I'm a federal employee, so I can't come across as publicly endorsing a particular software over another. I can tell you we use a suite of software, and then if you want to talk to me offline, we can absolutely do that.
Okay. And do you have one staff person dedicated to that daily insights report? Or okay.
Yeah, we have four people who start at 8, 8:30 at 9, and we work on it. It's usually done by 12.
Okay.
It is labor intensive, but people really like it. You know, part of it is, if you have the Santa Cruz Sentinel, which is a really small newspaper, that may not mean much to the person who's in the Board of Governors, but for the person who is handling the Pacific area, having that mentioned totally makes their day. And so for the level of detail that we go into, it's well worth the investment.
Okay, thanks much.
Sure. Any other questions or comments? Oh, I see one right there.
Hi, thank you. Just curious, how do you measure like metrics over metrics? So do you do week over week, day over day, season over season? I'm sure there's a lot of okay. crisis management. It's hard to kind of mm-hmm. measure things apples to apples, but what type of metric over metric do you use? What time frame?
Okay, so we use various ones for different purposes. So for example, for the holiday season, that's year over year. Or for customer social response, that's year over year. But we also report weekly what's going on. So what was the top post for the week? What were the metrics over a week? And then for a crisis situation, we're taking the temperature typically every day, but if it's something that's very time sensitive, we're doing it every few hours. Yes.
Start local and go national, or do you go national and drill down into local?
It's a false choice because we pull up both. The software pulls up both automatically. And it actually maps it out automatically for us as well.
And how is your team structured? Is everyone work on the local and national pieces of the business, or do you have dedicated folks looking at different aspects?
Great question. So we allow people to focus on things that are of greatest interest to them. Like some people are interested in policy, some people are really interested in local level, but because people are allowed to get sick and go on vacation and have developmental experiences, everyone knows how to do everything. Yes.
Hi. How do you separate customer service opportunities versus marketing opportunities, and what's the volume like for both?
I'd say that the customer service opportunities are much greater because people are coming to us. But I think the marketing opportunities are there if you listen to what those customer concerns are. So for example, we had like 15% of our folks were asking questions about international mail because they weren't clear on how international mail works. So that was a marketing opportunity that we need to develop further. Any other? Yes.
Execution. Oh. From your crisis detection to execution, how long does that normally take?
It depends on the volume. So usually maybe within 2 hours is what we say to folks. Give us 2 hours at least. It also depends. So for example, if someone posts a less than flattering video, we may have an answer for like whether or not it's gained traction within a half hour. If it's like the market watch issue, that took 3 hours. But then we read through hundreds and hundreds of comments about the article in support of us. Any other questions or comments? All right, so I have a confession. This is my first time presenting on this to an external audience. So, thank you. So, I do have some swag for you guys. So I have stamp pins, and the Scooby-Doo ones are actually magnets. So I'm going to be hanging out by the water cooler for a bit. So if you want to get some free swag and come by and say hello, I would love to chat with you further. Thank you all so much. I really appreciate your coming out.
I never go back.